I don't have enough musical skill to account for my rage, so I became an actor.
At first, I heard you wanted to be a drummer.
Oh yeah, who doesn't? Everybody wants to be a drummer, or an astronaut, or an apple. I wanted to play the drums when I was young because you got to hit things really loudly, and I must have had some deeply suppressed rage. And that was a good way for me to exercise that rage. But I don't have enough musical skill to account for my rage, so I became an actor. Every actor I know, even like the most successful actors, like still go through periods where they don't work for 6 months and they question all of their life decisions. The difference for me is that like I spend half the year writing stuff, so I don't feel like bored. My mother was like a birthday party clown, so she like was not in a circus. She would just do local birthday parties. I did a very different kind of job than her because I, you know, act in dramatic movies, and it's a very kind of like serious and more sophisticated form of performing, you could say. But last year I played Marcel Marceau, the French mime, in a movie. And so I kind of started to appreciate the more clowning type performance.
What good does it do to teach them fear? I think it's important to help the children laugh in the middle of this war.
When I was in high school, I was just desperate to not be in high school. So I tried everything, like auditioning for plays, writing movie scripts. I was just trying anything to get a job that a young person could do to get out of school, because I just hated it so much. And so I did get certain jobs, like I would get into a play and you'd have to do the play on a Wednesday during the day. You know, we have the matinee. That's a French word, isn't it? Matinee. Yeah. So I got to miss Wednesday. So it was like, thank God I got into this play. Now I can at least one day a week. And one of the things, I was trying to write scripts. So some of them, as you said, like optioned by companies in Los Angeles, but they never got made. But it just gave me another way to like kind of get out of my situation. Yeah, I don't know. I think I had like emotional issues when I was younger. So, now it's great because I do a job where you're expected to be emotional and, you know, cry in front of all these other adults. But in school, that's not, doesn't make you very popular.
Yeah. She took out 420s cause she liked round figures. Everybody's free for a day. Oh, babe, I'm on fire and you know I admire your body. Why don't we slip away?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of actors probably have a similar experience, which is that you have some, like, deep discomfort with yourself, you know. Lots of people have that kind of feeling, of course. But sometimes actors are attracted to acting because it allows them to kind of get out of themselves a little bit. It gives them some relief from their own, you know, anxieties. So, yeah, I meet a lot of actors like that.
All right, here we go. Get this straight. Sex is everywhere, okay? It is all around us. It's not some distant destination. It's not Everest. It is right here. You have to attune yourself to it. You have to bring yourself into alignment. You have to find the zone, Nick, okay? Do that, and I promise you, a whole world will open up.
The first good part I had in a movie was this movie, Roger Dodger, and it was like such a misleading experience. I met a lot of actors who had a similar situation, where it's like you get to do something really great when you're young, and you assume that everything is going to be like that. Being in like a great movie that people like that turns out well is like very difficult and it's rare and all that. So like, it was a kind of misleading opportunity. So I was like so happy to do that movie, and then like subsequently like disappointed when movies weren't as good. After I saw that movie, Roger Dodger, that was like in 2002 or 3 or something, I called my father after that movie. I said, I have to quit acting. I didn't like watching myself. It was so disturbing. I didn't think I did a bad job in it. I just hated looking at myself. And I think any sane person has this reaction to themselves. You know, you hear your voice on a people don't have answering machines anymore. So what do you hear your voice? What's the new thing? TikTok. Is that a new thing? Is that a real thing? So TikTok or something, you know, and you're like, I look like that? I sound like that? It's so strange.
So you haven't seen The Social Network?
We had to go to like some public screening of that where we had to like, you know, wave and everything. And I was forced to sit down, but I didn't look up. I mean, I looked up for a second. All the actors in Zombieland are like so surprised by the reaction that the movie engenders in people, because it's like a horror comedy, but people talk about the movie, fans talk about the movie like it's this important movie in their family. I mean, the script is really good, and the director's good, and the actors are good, but I think the success of it is that it's like a very emotional movie. Mm. It's about these people who are trying to form a family, but the surface of the movie is like very funny and like scary, and so I think it allows people to like experience emotion that they're not that they're embarrassed to feel. Yeah. So if you're watching like a horror comedy and it has like kind of like lowbrow jokes, it makes you feel safe, but that you can then you can experience the emotion that you want to experience. When I was first in movies, the movie that you referenced, Roger Dodger, the character was such a sweet, yeah, virginal character that I got like, I would say, you know, like every other actor, you just get sent scripts from this thing that you're known for. Mm. And every actor, of course, has frustration with that. You want to play the opposite. So then I just wanted to play mean people or arrogant people.
You're obsessed with finals clubs. You have finals clubs OCD and you need to see someone about it who will prescribe you some sort of medication. You don't care if the side effects may include blindness.
Final clubs, not finals clubs. And there's a difference between being obsessed and being motivated.
Yes, there is.
I didn't really think of it as like a story about this real person, because the script was so good and written by somebody who was known for other kinds of styles, you know, so it didn't exactly feel like doing like the Judy Garland story or something where it's this like celebrated tortured person.
I believe I deserve some recognition from this board.
I'm sorry?
Yes.
I don't understand.
Which part?
It just felt like this is an interesting movie that could have just as easily been fiction,
yeah,
you know, because it's a story about, you know, ambition and power and, you know, and creation and stuff like that. And it didn't feel like I was playing a person who's been in like the public psyche for the last, you know, half century.
I'm not so sure you want to be me.
I don't.
Give my best to Jan.
You know, it's like when you're playing a real person, you have like take a little bit from their lives, mm, but you're also kind of thinking like, well, how would this real person react to these circumstances, which are a little bit dramatized, you know, yeah, and stuff. That was just great because I loved David Foster Wallace in college, and you know, it was great to be in that world of this guy who was special and, you know, here too briefly, and in a way, it celebrated David Foster Wallace, but also kind of showed him as like, you know, it's a complicated person. And the actor who played it, Jason Segel, was so great in it because, you know, he showed that, you know, he showed the selfishness of him, he showed the brilliance of him. And it was just it was a great, great project.
The situation is fraught with peril.
Oh, give me a break. Her friend is coming. What do I care? I'm not looking for anything. I'm perfectly happy with Sally. And actually, judging from Sally's description, Monica's kind of like a neurotic, unpredictable type. Yeah, it was weird being on a Woody Allen set. I mean, the first set I was on, I don't really think I even spoke to him that much. An assistant director came over and gave me a note, you know, try it this way instead. Normally when you work on a movie with the director, you know, you're discussing the character months beforehand, sending each other videos, and you know, it's this really collaborative process. With Woody Allen, like the first movie I did with him, I didn't even see him. I acted in the scene, somebody told me where to walk and say the lines, and I did the scene, and then that same person came over and told me to do it faster, and I did it faster, and then then we went to a different location. I didn't even see him. So that was a really surreal experience. And then the second movie I did with him, you know, we had known each other by that point. He was really nice to me and supportive of me. He had come to see my plays in New York, and so he knew me as like a writer and a thinking person, and so I think he maybe had some more affection for me or something. And so we had like a kind of, let's say, stronger relationship. And the second movie I did with him, that was much more kind of fulfilling and surreal because it was a period piece. It was about, you know, there was so many scenes with jazz and, you know, 1920s music.
I don't think that's a very good idea, actually.
No?
I'm seeing someone.
Oh. What's he like?
Doug is a journalist.
Oh. I just thought since you had so much free time on your hands.
He travels a lot. And I really like spending my time with you. I hope that's okay. You know, you're very sweet. Have you heard that before? You have this deer in the headlights quality.
Thank you. Well, if I was your boyfriend, I would not travel. Or if I did, I would take you with me.
It felt like I was in the Disneyland version of a Woody Allen movie. Like, all these things from other Woody Allen movies were in this movie. So it kind of felt like being in a theme park, like a Woody Allen theme park, you know. I'm dating two women, and we're watching jazz together, and it's like New York in the sunset. You know, Jewish humor and people talking about, you know, what Kierkegaard would say, you know, that kind of stuff.
Studied anthropology.
Yeah, yeah.
Was it a good way to learn more about the job of actor?
Anthropology is like the study of other cultures, and as an actor, it's also kind of helpful because, you know, in anthropology, the thing you learn is not to judge another culture. You know, if it's something you wouldn't do, it doesn't mean it's less than. It just means it's different. You know, I've played movie villains before, but in anthropology, you're not supposed to judge somebody's behavior. You're supposed to kind of see it in the context of what their culture is. And so as an actor, you're kind of looking at characters without judgment. You know, even in a movie like a Batman movie where it's really good versus evil, you try to figure out, well, it's not just evil. He has some real motivation that we can relate to.
Because you, my friend, have a date. Across the bay, grapefruit his hate. 2 years growing, but it did not take much to push him over, actually. Little red notes, big bang, you let your family die!
Yeah, I mean, they gave me like an hour and a half to read the script. They said, oh, do you want to play this character? Here's the script in about an hour and a half. It's going to be deleted from your, you know, computer. So I sat down to read it, and it just took forever because it was so dense. There were references to things I'd never heard of, and I was shocked because I had never seen a superhero movie because I live in a bubble or whatever. And so, I thought it was just going to be, you know, people flying around or whatever for 100 pages. But it was, it was so intellectually probing that I got deleted before the allotted time. I didn't finish it, but, you know, before it got deleted, so I had to call and get an extension.
That should be upside down. Now, we know better now, don't we? The devils don't come from hell beneath us, no. No, they come from the sky.
That was written by this guy, Chris Terrio. You know, he wrote the Batman versus Superman. He, referenced things in that movie that are so, intellectually probing. I don't know how many people watching that movie know his references, or even if they stayed in the final cut of the movie. But that script was, one of the most, dense scripts I've read intellectually, because this guy who wrote it is just, he's a genius. And it was weird in that kind of a movie to have dialogue that is so sophisticated and referencing Greek literature and, you know, and philosophy and the great moral struggles of the world, but in this kind of superhero movie.
Number 9 again. Did we just do some kind of loop?
How if we just...
Want me to drive?
Such a joke.
Because I think it's just not possible. We can't make turns like this over and over.
We have gone this way, Tom.
Oh my God.
Hello?
When I read Vivarium, I thought, this is just such a brilliant, artful commentary on modern life, because it's not saying, you know, modernity is bad or raising a child is bad or buying a house is bad. It's not like an obvious commentary on those things. What it does do is it displays like the worst nightmarish version of these things in a way that is never obvious. It's never specific. And it's always a bit surreal. When I read the script, I had been married and had a child for a year. So reading a script about, you know, a guy who gets married and has a child, but is presented as living in a hell, you know, is not the best way to, you know, spend your first year of marriage. In a way, I could relate to the anxieties that the character had. I'm sure everybody who moves in with their girlfriend, you know, has some unconscious anxiety about, you know, this is the last person I'll ever live with. And when you have a child, you know, this is somebody that is going to outlive me, and the anxieties of your own mortality. These are normal, healthy anxieties to have.
What would be the character you've played that is very like you, that is very close to you as a person in real life?
I mean, probably the most similar kind of character, which I've played a few times, is in Zombieland, because it's like a, you know, he's like the kind of funny, self-effacing, practical, nervous person. I guess that's probably more like me.
Stay back, 406, okay? I don't want to hurt you, but... Shit.
And I like playing it. It's frankly really much more difficult to play something like that because you're so aware of every little thing you're doing because it's real, you know, as opposed to playing a villain in a movie where everything is in your imagination. It's so much easier to play those things. When you're playing a character that's very similar to you, you become very self-conscious because you know that it's not authentic. The one little detail is off and it feels like it's totally incorrect. To me, that's be quite a challenge, but it looks easy to an audience because it seems relatable.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.